No, we'll do the quiz first, and then we'll have open questions, and then. First equation. Solving an equation means finding that number A that makes the equation true. You can find a number that you can throw in there, and then all the arithmetic over here causes you to get one, then fantastic. But one thing that I want to caution against, because I saw this in another class and I've seen it throughout the years, is just guessing. I know that clearly I'm going to subtract 5 from that's going to be 6, and I'll just throw some numbers in there until that comes out 6, or until this comes out to be 1. Guessing and checking. Right? Guessing and checking. You guess what A could be, you plug it in, you see if it works, and eventually you find A. Okay? How many of you are still guessing and checking as a reliable, everyday go-to strategy?
If I'm like totally not sure.
Good. If it looks foreign and new, then guessing and checking is a good way to get started. But eventually, you want to get away from guessing and checking. Okay? And if it's on a quiz and I put it up there, you can guarantee I do not intend you to guess and check as the means to finding the answer. If you're guessing and checking on the quiz, that's just an indication like, oh, I should probably practice these kinds a little bit more so that it doesn't seem so foreign and new. So, if you are doing that, if you are on a regular basis guessing and checking and you didn't raise your hand, ooh, it's gotta end, because you can't do that forever. You can't do that even for very long in this class. Algebra equations, algebra 1, they're, for a long time, they're pretty simplistic, and we can get away with it, but we just can't get away with it forever, and not for this year at all. Alright, anyway, that's just a little thing about guessing and checking. So what we need to do, we have this more exact method of canceling things out on one side and doing an equivalent operation on the other side, and isolating that variable. So how will we start to isolate that variable? What's one step that gets us a little closer to that? Yes?
Subtract 5 from both sides.
Subtract 5?
Or add 5.
Add 5. -5 plus 5 is 0. 1 plus 5 is 6. Okay. The number we're looking for, 1/3 of that number is 6. So,
multiply by the reciprocal.
Multiply, exactly right. Multiply by the reciprocal of this fraction.
On both sides.
On both sides. So we get 3 over 3. They cancel each other out. We get 18 over here. And A on the right side. So A must be 18. How do we check it?
Plug it in.
Plug it in for A. You just take it all the way back. And that's useful. Sometimes you figure out something went wrong. Either I plugged it in wrong or I solved for it wrong. So put it in here, 18 times 1/3. 1/3 of 18 is 6 minus 5 is 1. Worked out. Now we have a new element to solving equations. What's the new thing about this equation versus this equation? Variables on both sides. We don't want variables on both sides. If they remain that way, we'll never find out what n is. You've got to get variables to be only on one side. Okay. So what should we do?
Add
7 on both sides. That's great. That gets just variables on this side, because this cancels out. 7 plus 5 is 12 minus 2n. So the only thing over here is variables. That's a good move.
Add
2n. So we get 6n equals 12. And then what?
5
by 6. We get to the point where we don't even write that down, right? We divide by 6. 5 by 6 is. Write that next step. And so we went from variables on both sides to, hey, variables are on both sides, but now some of the variables are inside these parentheses. And how do I get them out of those parentheses?
Distribute.
What? Distribute? I heard distribute, okay. So we distribute the negative 4, and negative 4n minus 8 equals 3 times n minus 12. And now what is it? It's just like this. We have variables on both sides. So what should we do?
Add 4n.
Okay, just to show that it's all the same, whatever we do, as long as we do the same thing on both sides. Instead of adding 4n, I'm going to subtract 3n, just to be different. So I'm going to get negative 7n minus 8 equals negative 12. So now what would you do?
Add 8.
Add 8, cancel. Add 8, negative 7, n equals 8 minus 12 is negative 4, divide by negative 7. N is equal to positive 4/7. Okay, this is the answer I want to see. Not because, well, if I put this in a decimal, what decimal will it give me?
I have no idea.
0.571.
4 divided by 7. Is that where it ends? Does it just stop right there magically?
No.
How far does it go?
Forever.
Okay. Well, we could. What can we do? Can we put 5, 7, 1, 4, 2, 8, and then put a line over it? Okay, which, what does that line over it represent?
Keeps on going.
Well, I guess you could, but you don't know for sure that there's a 2 and an 8 after that 4. Okay, calculator hasn't told you that. You could do long division by hand and figure out that it does repeat over and over and over. And when you do the long division process, you'll see there's no way to avoid it. It'll just keep repeating the same algorithm over and over. But for one thing, we don't know that there's supposed to be a 2 and an 8 there. And that took a lot more work to do the long division to prove that it does repeat. So it's a lot less trouble to leave it as 4 over 7, I think. And it's more exact. Especially if you put 0.571 or something like that. That's nowhere near 4/7. You can zoom in close enough on the gap between 0.571 and 4/7, and it becomes very, very large. So the main reason is because if you write a decimal approximation, it's wrong. It is not the correct number. Okay? 4/7 is exactly right. 0.571 is approximately right, which is just as good as wrong. So 4/7. What I want to see is 4/7. All right? If you had 4/7 and then right after that you put 0.571, I'll cry for you because you have it and then you just put a decimal. Because I don't know. Sometimes for some people, decimals feel like a nice cozy blanket. They feel better when they see a decimal and a fraction's frightening. But we're not going to be afraid of fractions. We're going to leave them as fractions. Now, if the answer were 1/2 and you put 0.5, I can't argue. They're exactly the same thing. So I would accept that answer. But it's this approximation. It's just more breaking a habit so that you don't put the approximation when you should give the exact answer. Enough of that. Okay. Here we're faced with variables on both sides and fractions. So what should we do?
Add two ninths.
Add 2/9. So for now, what I'll write is 3/7 W. 4/9 W plus 1/7 plus 2/9. You want to do a common denominator for these two right here?
Yeah.
Okay, so what is the common denominator going to be?
63.
How will I get 63 out of 2/9? Or how to out of 9?
Multiply
by 7, so we got to do that in the numerator and denominator, which is multiplying by 1 here. So we're not changing anything. Multiply this by 9. 9 over 9, multiplying by 1, nothing changes. So we get 9/63 plus 14/63. So what do we get all together? 23/63. Okay. So now, still have 4/9 W plus that 23/63. W. What now? Subtract 4/9 W from both sides. 23 sevenths W minus 4 ninths W equals 23 sixty-thirds W. Not W, just 23 sixty-thirds. So now?
What?
Common denominator again, so we know we're going to multiply by 9. 9, 7, 7. Multiply by that. 9 times 3, 27 sixty-thirds. 28 sixty-thirds. 27 sixty-thirds minus 28 sixty-thirds is 1 sixty-third, negative 1 sixty-third. 23 sixty-thirds. Okay, now we're going to know what 1, positive 1 times W is. How are we going to get positive 1 times W over here?
Multiply by the reciprocal.
Multiply by the reciprocal. Multiply this by negative 63 over 1. Negative times negative is positive. Multiply this by negative 63 over 1. We get cancellation here. These are positive now. W equals 63 cancels with 63. And we have negative 1 times 23. Negative 23. How's that?
Good.
And any questions on the quiz? Questions from the homework other than questions on the quiz? Okay, let's pass in our homework.
No, it's not in there. I didn't do it.
What do I need?
What?
What do I need?
I don't know.
What do you?
I don't remember. What?
What are you telling me? Today we're going to be talking about these things over here. Okay, maybe you've never been in a class before. So the teacher talks, and you learn.
How's it going?
By not talking.
Ready.
Let's ask you too. Okay, so today we're going to be talking about, starting by talking about something I call the relation. Then we're going to learn about special kinds of relations, a subset of relations called functions. We're going to see how we can represent functions in lots of different ways. We're going to look at something and figure out if it's a function or not. And that'll probably be, judging by the other two classes, where we end. Okay, so let's start with a relation. A relation really is a general thing. This factory here, we can call it a relation. All right. A relation relates things, one thing to another. So something goes into the relation, we call that thing, it goes in, so we call it input. We put it in there, it's called input. And then when it comes out, it's called output. Okay. So the relation takes an input and relates it to an output. Okay. Clear enough? There. So that's all it is. Now, I regret picking 12 different things. That's what I'm going to move these 12 things over here. This relation just takes every input and relates it, because it's a relation, to an output.
How do you do that? I feel like you can lose one.
The number's changing.
Not only have to get across the thingy,
it's getting across
the thingy.
Okay. So I'm going to highlight all these, and I'm going to send them all back.
Ooh.
Then,
nothing.
So now we can see all of the inputs and all of the outputs. And that's what these words at the top are all about. If you want to do yourself a favor, you pay close attention to whenever I talk about inputs and outputs, because input-output is the very basic idea of what a relation and a function are. So when I talk about inputs and outputs, write it all down, internalize it, make it a part of your soul. And that way, when we talk about something else and I relate it back to inputs and outputs, it brings it back and makes it very simple. It's a very simple definition, and we can, you know, talk about it in a fairly easy way. If we continue on and you just forget what inputs and outputs are, you don't have a good, strong understanding of those words and what they mean, you can really struggle, and I can struggle to explain things to you, or I re-explain what inputs and outputs are. Okay, so good words to remember. All of these are inputs, because these are the things that go into the relation. All of the inputs together, you collect them, you put them in one place, you talk about them as a group. That group is called the domain. So all of the inputs collectively are called the domain. So what's the domain of this relation?
12.
Not how many there are, but what they actually are, what numbers they are. They are, the numbers in the domain are whole numbers, but is the domain all of the whole numbers? We're not describing what the numbers are, we are actually saying what the numbers specifically are. They are inputs. All the inputs together make up the domain. The domain is made up of what numbers?
1 through 12.
1 through 12. We could just write this, you know, all these numbers in a list. We could also say, well, we could say all whole numbers, okay? All whole numbers. 1 through 12. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12. That's a good description of the numbers in this domain. All right. What are these numbers called? Like, what's this number called? That's an input. This is an output, right? Input. So we have output. So each individually, these things here are outputs. This is one output, this is another output, this is another output. Those are all inputs, input, input, input. So if we collect all the inputs together in one group, in one set, what do we call that set? The range, exactly. Okay. This will take forever, so we'll do it. What is the range of this function?
Point 0.4.
Point 0.4?
Yeah.
Okay. So there's a word range, and the range could mean a couple different things. Now, you might have done some work with some data, maybe algebra, or maybe just some more with data in like one of Ms. Briney's classes, or in a science class, something like that. And there is one definition of the word range, and it is to take the largest thing and subtract the smallest thing, and the data ranges from here to there. And that's not what this is. In this context, range means the same thing as domain, except for instead of all of the inputs, it's all of the outputs. Okay? So what is the range of this relation? Point 0.7 to 1.8?
Yeah.
Okay. That's kind of the same idea as 1 through 12, but not all of the numbers between 0.7 and 1.8 are represented there. Right? If we state it just right, if we say all the numbers, the whole numbers, we specifically say whole numbers between 1 and 12, okay, that gets all of them, and it doesn't get anything it's not supposed to. So there's a lot of numbers between 0.7 and 1.8, like 0.863954. That's between 0.7 and 1.8.
So like all tenths?
Huh?
All tenths, 0.7 through 1.8? Because they
okay.
None of them go over.
Let's see, 0.7, 0.8, 0.9, 1, 1.1, 1.2, where's 1.3? So it was close to working, but 1.3 is not in.
Gotcha.
Not
gotcha.
In there.
I'm
okay.
With you.
How are we gonna say this?
Just
you just have to list them all. But the difference about range is that, or, well, domain and range, we don't have to write the ones that repeat twice. It just if it's there, it's there. It exists. Okay. So I'll use a squiggly bracket because that means a set of numbers. I would do the same thing really for domain. The set.
So the range is all the numbers?
The range is just the numbers that you see, all the outputs that you see here. You can write them in order, or we don't have to write them in order. We can just go down the list. Here's 1.2. 1.2. Okay. After 1.2 is 0.8. 0.8. Okay. Then there's 1.0. We don't have to write 0.0 if we don't want to. We just write 1. Well, there's one again. We don't need that. 1.8. That's a new one. Point 0.9. And we got 1.2. Oh, that's already there. 1.1. That's a new one. 0.7. 0.8. There we got 0.8 already. 1.2. We had 1.2 already. That's it. That's all of them. Close the squiggly brackets, that's all the numbers that appear in the range. They're all the outputs. We're going to talk more about domain and range. We're going to take a break from that for just a second. We'll talk about all the ways we can represent a relation. Well, just the way we have it right now certainly conveys a relationship between those numbers and these numbers. The only thing missing is that we need to be very clear about which output or which input goes with which output, right? That's what we need to be clear about. How can we convey which input goes with which output? Michael?
Like a chart.
Okay, so we can make a chart or a table is the word that we use. And so how would that look?
Kind of like two boxes, one says like input, the other says output, and you have to
yep.
list it.
Okay. So I'll do this a little early since you brought it up. I'm gonna bring a table up. A relationship can be it can make sense or it can make no sense. Okay, there is some sense between these inputs and outputs, but a relation can take an input like cat and send it to an output like blue. Okay, well that doesn't make a lot of sense. It's just what that relation does. It relates a cat to blue. Some people have a condition called synesthesia. Has anybody ever heard of synesthesia? Yeah?
Yeah.
What's synesthesia?
I remember it from psychology. Is that where, like, it's with colors, though?
It's with colors. Colors and what?
Numbers?
Numbers. So there are people who, when they think of a number, they relate it to a color.
What?
And the thing is, like, synesthesia isn't such that all people see one as green. They just see them in their own little way. And it's just what their brain automatically does.
Weird.
There's so many colors.
Huh?
Yeah.
I mean, there's so many numbers, not colors.
Yeah,
so.
And then you it depends on who you talk to. Like, say that 2 is blue, and 5 is yellow. 2 is blue, 5 is yellow. So for a particular person that I saw an interview with, 2 is blue and 5 is yellow, so 10, 2 times 5, was
green.
One. Okay. That's just how they saw it. Or,
just automatically does it.
Or for other numbers, the same person, for longer numbers, that they don't just automatically, like, it would be a cool function of the brain if the color revealed all the factors of that number, right? If they saw a mixture of just automatically their brain did, but they don't do that. They only see it as 10 because they already know it's 2 times 5. So sometimes this person would see each digit as the color that it is. Right? 2 is still blue and 5 is still yellow. Okay. So anyway, that's a relationship. It doesn't make any sense to anybody who doesn't have synesthesia. Okay.
So this on the internet? Like,
yeah.
YouTube and stuff?
Yeah.
Okay. I'm going to check it out.
Check it out.
Right, so
there's a YouTube channel called Number File.
I don't know if I'll go there.
Well, it's got an interview with a lady with synesthesia.
All right, I'll check it out.
Number File. Like an audio, you know what an audio file is?
Yep.
A person's an audio file if they like
sound,
music, and quality sound, yeah. So, like this meeting, I like this thing. I like
number file.
It's
kind of like pedo.
I wasn't going to bring that up.
All right.
Number file. You like numbers. So there's an interview on there. You could search that for synesthesia. I have no idea how to spell synesthesia, but you can look it up.
Are you just, like, bored with it?
Synesthesia?
Yeah.
It seems like it.
No, you just, like, give it to yourself.
Like, can I try really, really hard
like
to relate a color to a number?
I think it's more something that it's just what your brain tends to do. My brain, when I was growing up, I tended to see numbers as male and female. And like mean or nice.
What?
Okay. Anybody else? So yeah? Male and female? Nice and not nice? Like 5. It's 5 male or female?
Male.
And mean or
that's my lucky number.
And mean, yeah, the mean guy. 5. Mean guy. What about 8?
This is the weirdest thing I've ever done.
8's female.
And she's nice.
And nice, yeah, kind of like a motherly
figure.
Oh my god.
What's
7? Is 7 a guy?
7's a mean number.
A mean girl.
A mean man. Okay, this is all we're getting this. Okay.
Let's be done. I said let's be done. I don't like making my brain do things that it shouldn't do.
Okay. So your relations can make sense or they can not make sense. That's my point. But this data here, it does make sense. It does fit a mold, okay? These numbers are representative of a month, January, February, March, all the way through December, and this over here is average precipitation in that month. And that writing's getting away.
Ooh.
Well, get over it. So the month over there, January through December, average precipitation that month, so in January you got about 1 1/2 inches of something, rain or snow or whatever. And then 9, what's that related to? Which month is that? What's that go back to?
8? 7?
I think go back to 7. These are a little more squished than those ones are. This actually go back to 7. That's July. Not as much rain in July. A lot of rain in May, June.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, May and June, it rains a lot. Okay? So that's what this is. And all the way back, finally, to what Michael said. We can represent this as a table. We could even pick it up and move it. We can have a table that relates the inputs to the outputs. There we go. That's maybe smaller.
Is the accurate interpretation?
Is it accurate?
Yeah, is that like, did you actually like your thing?
Oh, I just go back Googled it. The first result I got is what I used.
Okay, yeah, yeah. I thought, I didn't know if you were just making it up.
Oh, not making it up.
Okay, cool.
Some data that somebody collected. So there's a table. The input, which doesn't even have to be numbers. It could be, like I said, cat, anything. So January relates to 1.2, February relates to 0.8, and on down the road. Okay, that's very clear. This input goes with this output. Okay, we could do that with this data. We could just put like lines across so that it's clear which relates to which. Okay, we can also do something like this. Now, if I put the 1.2 down here, 1.0 up here, now that straight across thing doesn't work, right? Right, I can't just go from the top one to the top one. It's not correct. I know that it should relate to 1.2, so how can we, what can we use to fix that? Draw an arrow. Okay, we'll draw an arrow. This arrow. And we'll make it an arrow. And we'll go from 1 to 1.2. That's the relationship we're supposed to see. 2, we'll go over to 0.8. That's okay. 3 needs to go up here to 1.0. Okay. And these happen to go straight across. Again, there's 12 of these. All the arrows are pointing from an input to its output. And now you can move them all over the place, and the arrows still tell you what goes with what. Okay, come way down here. And whatever. Okay. That's a little messy, but it is something that exists. It is something we should talk about. All right, so I'm going to use green now because I use green for the arrows. This is called a mapping diagram. This is a mapping diagram. How many different ways have we represented this function? This relationship? Two different ways, table and mapping diagram. Are we done yet? Garrett?
What's up?
Are you done yet?
Yeah, I got done. Yep.
Just finished. Fantastic. That's how we're going to have a lot of fun. So there's the mapping diagram in green with the green arrows. And another way that we can represent it is ordered pairs. Ordered pair, there's an order to it, being input comes first and output comes second. So the input of 1 comes out as, I can use the mapping diagram to see, it comes out as 1.2. 2, the output with 2 is 0.8. The output for 3, I could go up to the table and see what the output for 3 is. 3 is March, and come down to 1.0. And I can continue that on all the way through 12. So there's ordered pairs. Ordered pairs, they kind of lend themselves to another way of representing a relation, and that's a graph. Take these, just a small example of what we're working with. Go over to the next page. Draw a graph, we need a couple of axes. And this could be 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, January through December. If you look at the data, the smallest piece in the output is, well, let's see, let's look here. I think you said 0.8? 0.7? 0.7 in October. 0.7, and the largest is 0.8. So we'll go from 0 to 2, and I'll capture all of the full range of the data. So 1, how do I show on the graph that 1 is mapped? Okay, mapping is a word that just means what you kind of intuitively probably think it means. 1 is mapped to what? 1.2. How do I show that on the graph? What's that? 1 is x, 1 is the input, so input's along here. And where does the output go? It goes up and down, okay? one for January, positive 1.2 for 1.2 inches of precipitation. Over here, 2 goes to 0.8, so we write right there, draw a point right there. 3 goes up to 1, so here's 3, that goes right up to exactly 1. And we can plot all these points, we can even draw lines between those points, see what kind of trend is happening throughout the year. So how many ways is that? How many ways did we represent that relation?
4.
What do we have?
Mapping
diagram, table,
order pairs,
and a graph. Okay. So this is from your book. And this. So this is 4 different ways to represent the same relation. Negative 2 maps to 2, negative 2 maps to 2, negative 2 maps to 2, negative 2 maps to 2. Negative 2 also maps to negative 2. Again, you see it again, and again, negative 2 maps to negative 2. Just 4 different ways we can represent it. A relation, 4 that we want to concentrate on at least. And you can see there's not really a distinguishable pattern here. There's not really a reason why negative 2 goes to 2 and negative 2. It just does. It just does that. Whoever wrote that down decided that's what was going to happen. Okay. There's even another way. There's really another way we could represent a relation. And now this is the way we would represent relations typically in a math class. This is what we really care about. Relations that relate numbers to other numbers in an understandable, predictable, rule-driven way. Y equals 2x. Okay, this makes sense. Where are we going to put things in to this relation? Where does the input go? Into the x. The input goes into the x. That's typical. And where does it come out? Where does the output come from? It comes from y. All it means is we're going to put something in for x, we're going to evaluate this expression, and whatever this is, that's y. That's what comes out. That's the result. That's the output. So let's represent some inputs and outputs. A lot of times to represent inputs and outputs, we'll create this thing, a table. Table of values. Put a number right here, a number right next to it. That's the input with its output. So what input do we put into this function? What's that? Anything. 2? Sure, 2. Why not 2? Anything else? Can we put something else in there? 5? Anything else?
8.
Anything else?
4.
How long can we do this?
Forever.
Okay, forever. Well, let's say we listed all the integers. What are integers? They're what? You got notes on it. Integers. They can be negative. So, opposite to what? Whole numbers. What are whole numbers? 1, 2, 3, 4. Not fractions, right? Just what they sound like. Whole numbers. The whole thing. All of 1, all of 2, not just part of it. Okay, so the integers are 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, all the way that way, 0, negative 1, negative 2, all the way that way. All of the ones, they're not parts of numbers, they're entire numbers, and they can be positive or they can be negative. Well, let's imagine we could possibly, even though we couldn't possibly, but we could possibly write down all the integers in this column. Okay, so we get all done, we write down all the integers. Is there still more we could write? What could we write after we get done writing all the integers? Rational numbers. Now we can squeeze in between 1 and 2 and 3 and 4 and so on and so on. Okay, so that's one thing. That's one thing we want to consider. Let's put a negative number in there too. So what's the what when I put in 2, what's the output?
4.
How about 5? 8? 16, 4, 8, -1, -2. And again, we could do this as much as we want, okay? Let's say we got all done writing down all of these x's. What are all these things called?
Integers.
Okay, we jumped right to the very end. Together, they're all inputs. Together, they're all called the domain. Okay. Now, if you want to say what the domain is, D colon, D standing for domain. Let's look back at the beginning here. The domain here was the whole numbers between 1 and 12. 1 and 12, we could write it like that. Or we could just write 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12. Can we just write all of the numbers down in some squiggly brackets? Possibly actually write all the numbers, right? But that's what we talked about. We could write all these numbers. We could just write down numbers forever and ever and ever. We'd never be done, right? So how do we say what all the numbers in the domain are? A rule?
Yeah.
Okay, what's the rule? Like, where will I find numbers that I can put into this function? What kinds of numbers can I put in for x? Michael?
Numbers?
Whole numbers, yes. It, can I go bigger than that? Can I put other numbers in there?
Real integers.
Real numbers, integers, real integers. There's whole numbers that are contained within the integers. You go out from the integers, you get rational numbers. Can we put rational numbers in there? Yes. We can put irrational numbers in there, like pi. We can multiply 2 times pi. Sure. So all those together. What do we call all of those numbers?
Real.
They're real numbers. So any real number will do. Okay? All real numbers. You can write that out in words, all real numbers, or this symbol means all real numbers. You draw two vertical lines, and you make an R out of it. All the real numbers. Any real number you can think of, you can go in there. To ask yourself what's in the domain, you just ask yourself for this example. I'm going to put a number there. I'm just going to multiply that by 2. What can I multiply by 2? Anything. Any real number can be multiplied by 2. How about the range? What's the range of this function?
Same.
Is it the same? I can get any number I want out of this function?
Yeah.
Well, seems reasonable. Might as well check it out. Can you get really big numbers?
Yeah.
Can you get like a million?
Yeah.
Okay, just multiply by 500,000. Can you get, could you get 2? Get 2, multiply by what?
1.
Can you get 1? Can you get the number 1?
No.
Can you multiply by something and get 1?
0.5.
Wow. Multiply 2 by 0.5.
Smart.
Can you get 1? Can you get 0?
Yeah.
Multiply by
0.
Can you get negative numbers?
Yeah. Yeah.
Did you get all those numbers in the negative side?
Yeah.
That we just talked about. Yeah, we could do that too.
So
I can't possibly, I can get fractions, I can get decimals, I can get anything that I want. In the real numbers, so yeah, all real numbers works just fine. I'll section that off. How about this guy? Now they're multiplying 2 times x, now we're dividing 1 by x. Seems good. Lots of numbers. You can divide lots of, you can divide 1 by lots and lots of numbers. Seems like any number will work. What's a good idea is asking yourself the same kind of question that I was asking you before. So what you want to do is you want to figure out the domain is. The domain is a set of all of the what? The inputs. The domain is a set of all the inputs. So it's all the stuff you're going to put in for x. So in this example, we're going to divide 1 by something. What numbers can you divide 1 by?
Anything
big numbers?
Anything but 0.
Anything but 0. You can divide by big numbers, decimals, fractions. Can you divide by fractions? Divide by a fraction, you just multiply by the reciprocal.
Fraction. You can't divide by
fractions. If you did 2, well, I guess I'll use 1. 1 divided by, say, 3 fourths.
You can do that?
Sure.
Okay. Just checking.
For one thing, it's kind of a weak argument, but let's say it's 0.75. Can you divide 1 by 0.75? Can you believe that? Do you think your calculator would give you something? Yeah, it certainly would. But even better than that, when we divide by a fraction, it would be the same as what? Multiplying by the reciprocal, right? If I do that to both the numerator and denominator, cancel that out, and we wind up with 1 times 4 thirds as 4 thirds. So yes, we can divide by any fraction we want. It just would be the same as multiplying by the reciprocal. But what's the one thing that you cannot divide by?
Zero.
So how do we state this? How do we state what the domain is?
You could do like all real numbers and then exclude zero.
Sounds good. All real numbers excluding zero. You can say except for zero. All real numbers but zero. Whatever you want to say about it, to just convey what exactly the numbers are. All of them work except for zero doesn't work. You can't divide by zero. The range. What's the range of this function? What can you get out of it? What can you get by dividing one by another? You get fractions. What did you get? 1/2? You get 1/3, 1/4, about 2/3. Did you get 2/3? Sure, you just have to. Well, you know that you want to multiply 1 by 2/3 to get 2/3, so you'd have to divide by 3/2, so then when you multiply by the reciprocal, you get 2/3. So you divide by 3/2, you get 2/3. Okay, any fraction is achievable. Decimals, can you imagine that it's possible to find some number to divide 1 by to get 0.79632? Sure, it's out there somewhere. Believable, at least. Could you get really big numbers? Could you get a billion? Can you get a billion out of it?
Probably.
Let's see.
Don't show me how.
No.
1. What would I have to multiply 1 by to get a billion?
A billion.
But I'm dividing.
So we divide by 1 over a billion?
Oh, that's genius. 1 over a billion.
Oh.
Yes, because we multiply by the reciprocal of this fraction. And so that would be multiplying by 1 billion, right? That's equivalent. Whether you divide by 1 over a billion or multiply by a billion, it's all the same thing. Yep, we can get a billion, we can get 80 trillion, whatever we want to do, or just using the reciprocal idea. Can we do all that in the negative direction? Can we get negative numbers out of this?
Sure can. Yeah.
Sure can. Divide by a negative number, all the same reasoning works, just make them negative. Can you get 0? What would you divide by to get 0?
Zero.
You try, but you can't divide by 0. Maybe there's something else that you can divide by to get 0.
No.
The answer is just no, Carl says confidently. You just can't do it. Think about this. What would you multiply 1 by to get 0?
0.
Okay, so using that reciprocal idea, we could divide instead of multiply by 0, just covering up that 0. We can divide by 1 over 0, so the reciprocal,
that
0.
You can't do that, it doesn't make any sense.
It doesn't make any sense. 1 divided by 0, you just can't ever
thing.
Use that number.
It's not a real thing.
So no, it's not a real thing, it's not a defined thing. Okay, that won't work. And the only way you can multiply by something to get 0 is to multiply by 0. Right? And since division and multiplication are so closely linked, the only number that could possibly work to divide by would be 1 over 0, which doesn't make any sense. It's not a real thing. Okay? So, what numbers work? What numbers are in the range of this function?
All real numbers exclude zero.
Exactly the same thing.
Will it always be the same thing? Or
no.
Yeah.
We're going to look at one right now that is not the same thing.
Okay.
This color blue. All right, so we had two. We've been exposed twice to the idea of finding the domain of the range, so I want you to now see if you can synthesize this information. Can you apply it to this new situation and find the domain of range? So in your notes or in your minds, give it some good hard thought. What numbers can you put into the function? What numbers can you get out of the function? not a lot to write down as you think about this, so I should expect to see some smoke coming off the top of your head as you think really hard. You gotta make sense of your answers. Okay, so now we're talking about the domain. So is there a, can you square any number you want?
Try.
Yeah. Okay, so you're squaring it. But you know, so far you've used whole numbers. So, and you don't have to write it down. You can just think about it. Could I do a negative?
Yeah.
I do. Fractions.
Negative
1
over
0.
Negative
fractions by itself.
Yeah.
Multiplying negative
fractions
by itself.
Zero by
itself. You see any problem multiplying a number by itself?
Yeah, okay.
Divided by number, can't divide by 0. There's definitely a problem there. But is there a problem multiplying a number by itself? There's a number you can't multiply by itself.
I'm
just
going
to
write
0.
Okay. So we've got a half a domain.
But
it's really long.
Range is what I'm
going to multiply.
Get when you square it.
But then for the range.
Okay, the domain is a set of all the what? The inputs, the things that go in. Where do things go into this relation?
X.
They go into X. What are you doing to X?
Squaring it.
And that needs to multiply by itself. Okay, so we're looking for the domain, so we're looking for all the numbers that you can, in the very end, multiply by itself. Which numbers can you multiply by themselves?
All real numbers.
Sure?
All real numbers.
Yeah.
No problems.
No problem.
Two?
Yeah.
It doesn't even have to be real numbers, does it?
It doesn't even have to be real, but we're going to exclude the non-real numbers, the imaginary numbers, for now. So yeah, all numbers real and imaginary, but we'll just stick with the reals. There's no number you can't multiply by itself. Even zero, even negative numbers, they all could be multiplied by. Okay, or by themselves. So all real numbers, perfect. Now we think about the output. When you multiply a number by itself, what kind of numbers will you get?
Positive numbers.
Not always
number.
Bigger, a half times a half is a fourth, that's
yeah.
smaller.
Right.
Okay.
All positive.
All positive. You multiply a number by itself, it's gonna be exactly the same thing, right? So you either get a positive times a positive, which is positive, a negative times a negative, which is positive. Zero times zero.
Zero.
You get zero. Okay. So not strictly only positives. Positives and what else?
Zero.
Zero. And I can get any real number. Like, can I get 1.7?
Yeah.
Yeah. Some pair out there. 1.7 has a square root. Right? That's what we're saying.
Yeah.
Somewhere out there,
uh-huh.
You can multiply a number and get 1.7. Okay. So how do we say that? The range is.
All positive numbers and zero.
All positive, what kind of numbers?
Real numbers.
Real numbers. So here's real numbers. This is the positive numbers. And since zero is not positive or negative, we say we include zero and zero. So there's an example of where they're not the same thing. They're not going to be exactly the same. Okay. So I'm just going to change this just a little bit. How about if we did y equals x squared plus 2? Let's think about that one. Okay. The domain. What numbers can you multiply by themselves? And then after that, add 2. Numbers can you do that with? Well, then we're just asking the number to get squared again, right? And if I add 2, that doesn't cause any issues. We can do that to any number, so domain is still all real numbers.
That's really tricky.
Okay, so this must be where the twist lies. What numbers will you get out when you square a number and then add 2?
The same as the last one, except excluding 1 and 2.
Excluding 2? Could you get 2 out of this?
Yeah,
you could.
Yeah,
you could.
So excluding 1.
Zero. Excluding 1, what about 1.5?
1.1 or 1.0.
Oh, you can't stop, right? This is 9's forever.
Right.
Okay. So we've got to figure out a way to concisely say this. What numbers will you get out of this function? Because this part's going to be 0 or anything bigger than 0. So the whole thing, you're going to be adding 0 to 2 or something bigger than 0. So it's going to, what's the smallest number you can get?
2.
2, okay. So again, I ask, how are we going to relate this information? How do I tell you that the only numbers you're going to get out are what we just talked about?
All real numbers 2 and up.
All real numbers 2 and up. So we can say all real numbers. So that y is bigger than or equal to 2. Oh, well, if I already go ahead and classify in the second part of the statement that it has to be bigger than or equal to, we can't violate that. But if you were to put this, that'd be just as correct. If you put that they all have to be positive. This just could be seen as redundant, and that you could just say y has to be greater than or equal to 2. All right. So all of these are special kinds of relations that we call functions. They're special kinds of relations that we call functions. All right? to tell you what makes these things functions, it might not seem quite closed off enough, like fully defined. So let me show you what isn't a function, and we'll talk about why it's not a function. I'm going to show you this, which will turn out not to be a function. It's just a relation, the relation y equals the square root of x. I want you to tell me what the domain and the range are. First of all, so think about that.
We can find the square root of any number, can't you?
Okay, find the square root of any number. Give me a number you can find the square root of. Just give me an example.
5.
Square root of 5. Don't know what it is, but it's there. How about when you do know the square root of?
100.
Square root, what's the square root of 100?
10.
You do know. To say I don't know just before you say the answer is kind of weird. It's 10. Because, what's the proof that 10 is the square root of 100? 10 times 10 is 100. 10 squared is 100. So, I can find the square root of 100. Square root of 16. Square root of 4. Right? And let's write this down. Square root of 4 is 2 because 2 times 2 is 4. That's the proof. Because 2 times itself is 4. So now I'm going to ask what the square root of negative 16 is. It's what?
Can't do it.
Why?
Isn't it negative 4?
No. Isn't it negative 4?
No, it's negative 4 times negative 4.
Come on.
Negative 4 times negative 4 times exactly what the copy of it is positive 16. Right? What's the only way to multiply two numbers together and get a negative? Negative, positive. One of each.
So
well, that can't be
positive numbers.
Okay, so we can put any positive number into this. And?
Zero.
Zero as well. Can you find the square root of zero?
Zero.
Number times itself is zero. Zero is that number. About the range, what will you get out of this function? Well, it's not a function. What will you get out of this relation? Did I hear positive numbers? Okay. Can we only get positive numbers out of this? Yes?
Why does the domain all positive numbers? Or is that just plus zero?
It's all positive numbers.
But you just put a negative 16 in there and it comes out.
But the thing that we've discovered about that is we said, hey, is it negative 4? That's what the question mark is. If it were, then negative 4 times itself would be negative 16. But is it?
Oh, no.
It's positive. And if it were 4, 4 times 4, no, that's still positive 6. We can't multiply a number by itself and get a negative, because to multiply two numbers together and get a negative, you need one positive and one negative. And that's not, that can't be the same number. So that was why we can't do it. Can't find the square root of a negative. Okay, is the range all real or all positive numbers? You only get positive numbers out of that? That was the question. How about the square root of 25? What's the square root of 25?
5.
Why?
Because 5 times 5 equals 25.
Okay. 5 times 5 equals 25. Would any other number work?
No.
Negative
5 would work. Negative 5 times negative 5 is negative 25. So not only positive, but also negative 5.
So it's all numbers.
It's all real numbers.
So it's just flip flop the last one.
Yeah.
Yeah,
that's a very, very good observation. And it's no coincidence that it flip-flops the domain and the range of the last one, because the last one was x squared. Is there a relationship between x squared and the square root of x?
Yes.
What do we call that relationship? X squared and the square root of x?
Opposite.
Yeah, they're opposites in a way, but there's a specific word in math that we use.
So, what's that?
There's all sorts of opposites in math, aren't there?
Inverse?
Inverse. They're inverses.
One.
It's a kind of opposite.
Good job, Misty.
They're the inverse operation, right? So this one can take any real number, but can only give you out positive numbers. This one can only take in positive numbers and zero, and will give you out any number. But here's why this is not a function. It's just a relation. Okay. Because of what we just talked about, the square root of, say, 16 is positive and negative 4. If I take 16 and I put it in there, I put it as input, what's the output?
Two numbers.
What numbers?
4 and 4.
4 and also negative 4. That's a problem. Okay? A function's a simple thing. A function has a rule. Okay? A function assigns this thing to this thing. It takes things in and it puts things out. Now, if you put something into a factory, a good functioning factory, it's all automated, it definitely does this one thing, produces this one product. If you put in 16 into this factory and expect it to give you 4 or negative 4, it's not going to know which one to give you. It needs to just give you one thing. Okay? No choices involved, no questions in the air, it just is what it is. What goes in, decide what comes out. So a function is a special kind of relation. Function. What can you not have come out of a function?
Two outputs
for one input. You gotta have one output for one input. Who are you stalking?
Yeah. I wasn't gonna disrupt you.
Oh, that's okay. I disrupted class. Okay. Function. It's a relation. Special kind of relation, but it's a special kind of relation in such that you never get two outputs. So it's a relation for which every input, okay, so you're going to finish that. Every input what?
Has exactly one output.
Great, I love it. Input has exactly one output. How many outputs?
One.
Two outputs?
No.
Three?
No.
How about zero outputs?
No.
No, not zero outputs. It's got to come out with something and only one something. So that's what makes a function a function. Something goes in and only one thing comes out. Okay. So, not a function, right? How about these? Are these functions?
Yeah.
Why is that?
One output.
When you multiply a number by two, here's this example. Are you going to get two different things?
No.
No, it's definitely just twice that number. When you divide one by a number, there's only one result that could possibly happen. When you square a number, only one thing could possibly happen. Square a number and add two, only one thing can possibly come out. Okay, let's keep going back. How about this? This is a relation. Is this relation a function?
Yeah. No.
Why not?
Because one has two inputs.
Because negative two has two outputs.
Okay.
Two and two has four.
Okay.
Your input.
So there's one input or two outputs, right? Now, there's sometimes, well, there's every time I do this, there's confusion. You see the two ones and you say, hey, two inputs have the same output. That sounds exactly like what we said, but it's not exactly what we said. We said that every input has to have one and exactly one output. Does zero meet that? Does zero have one output?
Yes.
And only one?
Yeah.
Does three only have one output? They both happen to be the same output, but each of them just has one. But negative two, on the other hand, is an input that has two outputs. This is the part that makes it not a function. This is okay. Happens every year. It's a good thing to highlight. All right. I have to go on to the next part without staying on this for as long as I'd like to, but it'll be just fine. So watch out for that. If all these different inputs go to the same output, that's okay because all of them have one for each. But if one of them has two, that's where you have a problem. Okay. Function notation. So here is not function notation. Y equals 2x plus 3. That's not function notation. Function notation looks like this. F of x equals 2x plus 3. This is said F of x. If I say something is a function of something else, it just means it relies on that thing. Okay? Let's see. The boiling temperature of water is a function of what? What changes the boiling temperature of water?
Heat.
Altitude. If you change, maybe other things, but definitely altitude, pressure. Yeah, the external pressure outside the water. So altitude changing pressure, pressure changing boiling temperature. Okay? So it's a function of altitude. If you know the altitude, there's some equation that you plug it into and it'll tell you what the boiling temperature of the water at that altitude will be. It's a function of altitude. Okay. So f, the function f, it's a function of x, meaning depending on what x is, that'll determine what comes out of f. All right. So here's why we do function notation. For one, we give functions a name. Before, if we had a bunch of different functions written on a piece of paper, we would have y equals this, and y equals a different thing, and y equals another thing, and y equals a fourth different thing. And now when you talk about y, it's very ambiguous. Which one are you talking about? Right. Now it's not ambiguous. I can have f of x equals 2x plus 3. I can have g of x equals x squared minus 7. I can have h of x. Actually, I can have h of r, just choose a different letter, no big deal. H of r equals, and now I'm not going to see x over here. If I say x over here, that would be confusing. It's a function of r, okay? R minus 3 divided by 2. So I subtract 3 from r and I divide by 2. These are all functions. They depend on an input. This one's input is r, this one's input is x, this one's input is x. This one's name is f, this one's name is g, this one's name is h. Okay. Here's another reason why we do function notation. Okay. This at this point, it's a total guess, but maybe you can make an informed guess of what this means. What I want you to do. Okay. Here, multiply. Okay. Natural reaction to seeing a letter next to a parenthesis. These parentheses don't mean that. They don't mean multiply. Different stuff means different things in different contexts. Or actually, I guess the same thing means different things in different contexts. Like 1.2 means 1 and 2 tenths. 1 dot in the middle 2 It's 1 times 2. Okay? So it's the same symbols mean different things in different contexts. So this doesn't mean multiply. It doesn't
combine.
Combine what?
Combine G and 3.
How do we combine G and
3? 3G.
3G?
That's multiplying.
That sounds like multiplying 3 times G.
Huh?
Put a 3 in for x. What was here before I put a 3 here? X. Okay, so wherever there's an x, we'll now see a 3. So 3 squared minus 7.
Oh, geez.
That's all it is. 9 minus 7, 2. Knowing that, what is h of 3? Let's use 3 again, we will. The h.
Yeah, r.
3 minus 2.
R is 3.
Yeah.
R's 3?
Yep.
So what's h of 3?
Equals 3 minus 3 over
yep.
2?
Yep. 0. 3 minus 3 over 2, 0.
Yeah.
What? It's f of 3.
Okay, I don't see the f. Where's the f equation?
F is right here.
Oh, okay. Equals 2 3 times 3 plus 3.
Ooh. Which is?
I don't know.
Okay. So the other reason why we do function notation is it's easier to tell you what I want you to do and to which function. If it was a bunch of y equals, y equals, y equals, I would have to do something else, like maybe color code them, or point at them, or say the one in the middle, or whatever. But it's easier to identify functions. To say f, you know which function. And if I say f of 2, it quickly tells you put 2 in for x in the function that's named f. Like all of that information is in just a few pencil notes. Alright, that's why we do it. Don't multiply. F of x, f parentheses x, or g parentheses m or does not mean to multiply. It means to substitute that number in for that letter. Yeah?
Do we have to do both of those? The 2.1?
No, sorry. I forgot to mention. Just the 2.1.
Yes.
Just 2.1.
Yeah. Are you
going to
text it to us?
Yep. Yes. I wouldn't. If I was going to get a text message,
wait for it.
So 4 o'clock. That's when I'll send them out. Maybe you'll be at home and ready to work on homework. Or maybe not. 4 o'clock sounded good. Yeah.